In a world where God is dying, four heathens come to deliver the final nails in the coffin. From the depths of hell, Satan sends four puppets of the imperialist West and the Zionist Jews against God, Islam, and tiny kittens to bring you their propaganda and conspire for a new world order. This is Secular Jihadists from the Middle East.
Good evening from Baghdad. We have a guest with us today. I think we have a guest. I can see her. And we have three former members of the Nazi party. We have Hitler Ali, who killed himself but reincarnated.
Hi, everybody. This is not what I... Okay.
We have Nuremberg Navabi, who is responsible for many genocides, but he's joining us tonight. Also, and then we have Eva Abdulrahman Muhammad Brown, who is the former, who is the...
when did Abdulrahman come in?
So who's the former wife of Adolf Hitler, Adolf Abdulrazzaq Abdul Ali Hitler. And with you we have and I'm the host, Faisal Sharon Netanyahu, who's the host for the show. And today we have a new wonderful guest who Yasmin brought us brought our attention to. She Shazia from Scotland, and she's the author of Gori,
the Gori's daughter. Her name is Shazia Hobbs.
It's all the two words that I forgot one. Don't blame me. It's a blame the Heineken. It's a German conspiracy. So the Gori's daughter, was Gori stands for whites. In case you're white privileged, you're not allowed to watch our show. So Shazia, tell us more about yourself.
Hi, this is always the really awkward bit. Tell us about yourself.
Okay, so don't tell us about yourself. Okay. How is your Tinder profile? How is it going? Tell us.
She's married, Faisal. Back off.
I'm the
author. Did you assume her gender?
Did I what?
Nothing. It's a funny. He's got his dad jokes that he always repeats.
Okay.
Just tell us about yourself, Shazia.
I'm the author of The Gori's Daughter. Gori means white woman. I grew up in a polygamous home in Scotland. This is really awkward. Just ask questions. It's easier.
What motivated you to write your book?
Okay. I loved reading. I lived in the library when I was young, always reading books, and there was never any mixed race characters. So part of it was to have a main character that was mixed race, so other mixed race people could identify with it, and also to let other people know, I suppose, that, you know, they weren't alone. Other people that had gone through forced marriage, maybe children that were grown up in polygamous homes.
So when you talk about mixed race, can you tell us about the two races that you're talking about?
My dad's from Pakistan, Mirpur, Pakistan, and my mum is from Scotland. My dad's Muslim, my mum's Catholic.
Did she convert to Islam when she was married to your dad?
She converted, but she didn't pray or anything. She converted to keep the community happy, I suppose, to keep the family happy.
But then she went back to it after when they broke up?
Yeah, but I would say my mum's heart is Pakistani. She was with my dad for over 40 years. You know, so that's a long time to live in the Pakistani community.
And what about your heart? Is your heart Pakistani or is your heart Scottish?
Depends. Bit of both.
So what is a Pakistani heart and what is a Scottish heart?
I would say that I take the good things out of the Pakistani culture and take the good things out of the Scottish culture and try and make it my own.
So just to give our viewers or our listeners a background about your story, So your book is about you growing up in Scotland to, like you mentioned, a Pakistani dad and a Scottish mom. And something interesting about your background, which I share with you too, is that your mom was a second wife. And when we say second wife, normally in English, people think, oh, so you divorced the first one.
Yeah.
But in Muslim households, second wife has a different meaning. So my mom was a second wife to the man that she was married to, and your mom was as well. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that dynamic of having two moms in the household.
Yeah, that was, it's kind of strange because when you're in that home, when you're grown up, it's normal. You don't know anything else. So you might see other people around you. You know, I think we were the only family that I can remember that had two mums in the house, even in the Pakistani community. I think a lot of the Pakistani men that had taken second wives didn't have them in the same home. So they would be living in a separate home with their children. And it's just normal. It's just part of your upbringing. You don't know any different. There's never really going to be love, is there? If, you know, one man, two women sharing one man, it's hard enough for one woman to be with one man. And then you've got my stepmom's Pakistani. She was my dad's first cousin. So two different cultures as well. Two women with two completely different cultures in the same house was a little bit hard going.
And did you always know that your mom was your mom, or did you just think of them both as your mom?
Yeah, I thought of them both as, you know, my Pakistani mom was ummi and my mom was mummy. So when you're young, they're both your moms. And it's not until you get a little bit older you realise that you can only actually have one mom.
Yeah, and I remember in the book you talked about that being quite a shock, yeah, finding out that this was your actual mom.
Were you raised more Muslim-leaning, or were you raised more Catholic-leaning? Like, did they, or was there any direction in terms of your religious upbringing?
There was no Catholic religion, none whatsoever. We were very much raised as Muslim.
And that was because, was that because your mom converted, or was that because your dad insisted that, you know, you should be raised Muslim, or was it just kind of took precedence?
Yeah, I think, you know, that he's a Muslim man. So, and I think my stepmom as well, obviously, is Muslim. So that was the dominant religion. I used to hear my mum at night praying to her Catholic gods and doing the Catholic prayers.
Oh, like secretly, or?
Yeah, before she went to sleep at night.
Ah, interesting. So was it like a moderate Muslim kind of household, or was it more sort of, I guess, you know, you said that, did you say she wore the veil, or did I hear that wrong?
No, she didn't. No.
Oh, no, she didn't. Okay.
No.
So it wasn't, would you say it was more of a moderate Muslim household rather than a fundamentalist type?
Yeah. We were like, you know, I hear loads of, and I speak to loads of Muslim people that weren't allowed to listen to music. And I think, wow, because we had all sorts of music. I grew up listening to Bollywood. My dad loved Bollywood movies. Mm-hmm. And we listened to my mum's music as well. So they were strict. I would say we grew up in a strict home, but not overly religious.
Mm-hmm. But yet they still pushed you into an arranged marriage, which is typical more of the more religious Muslims.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us a bit about that?
Hell yeah. I was 18 when I was forced into marriage. I had no choice. None whatsoever. I tried to, you know, I can remember saying that it's not Islamic, it's against our religion to force me, you have to give me a choice. And I met him on my wedding night, which was quite horrific.
And he was from Pakistan, right? So he wasn't even Scottish?
No, he was from Pakistan. He married for the red passport.
Right. Was there a culture clash between the two of you?
There was a huge age gap between the two of us. He was really into politics, and he was just so much older. And I was quite immature for my age.
What was the age gap?
I was 18. He was in his late 30s.
Oh, okay. Well, that's quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
What was the motivation for the first? Like, why would your parents want that for you? Like, I don't understand.
Because I was becoming too westernized.
Say that again.
I was becoming too westernized.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
In Scotland, you were getting too westernized in Scotland.
In the West.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, but can you please define that for, I think our audience may not know what that means. What is the definition of too westernized?
I don't know. They found out I had a boyfriend.
Was your mom okay with the arranged marriage?
Yeah. Well, she wasn't, but she had no choice.
She had no
choice. Oh, wow. So it's kind of interesting. Like, I just wonder how you square. Did you ever ask your father, like, you know, hey, you know, you married a white Scottish woman, you know, the Gori, and, you know, you're telling me I'm westernized. Mm-hmm. So, and did that ever come up? Did you ever ask those kinds of questions? And
I wouldn't be clearly enough.
He was westernized too. So he must have been at some point to do what he did, right?
Yeah, I wouldn't have been brave enough to say that to my dad.
Mm-hmm. And how is it right now? Are you still in touch with your, no. Are you on good terms with them, or just isolated?
I walked out of my forced marriage when I was 21.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad disowned me. He told me I was dead. He didn't have a daughter called Shazia anymore. So I haven't had any contact with my dad for 25 years or something.
Oh, wow.
He's been out of my life longer than he was ever in it. So
it's a really common story. And this is something when we talk about all of our stories, everybody has something. I was actually, my ex-wife was also disowned for the same reason.
Okay.
So she was actually disowned when she was 17 or 18 because, again, she became too westernized. And
that's actually, to some extent, that sounds very fascinating to me.
Because it's a common thing with Muslims.
But that is in the UK, right?
That was me too.
That is in the UK. It's not in Egypt. It's not in Kabul. No. It's not a Raqqa. It's actually in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really interesting to see, because I mean, I come from Iraq, in case you don't know. And it is really interesting to see that the UK, with some, obviously, I don't want to generalize, but it does seem to me that there is more extremism in some parts of it than actually in Baghdad, where I grew up. And that's actually really interesting. It's actually to me fascinating because for me, when I think of the West, when I was living in the Middle East, is that I think of the West as liberal and everything is fine. And if you are coming from a Muslim background, you're mostly like the moderate type, the liberal type, etc. But like, I mean, first of all, one of the experiences that Yasmin shared with me growing up in Canada, and now you share growing up in the UK. That's actually pretty fascinating. I mean, can you tell us like more about the environment? Like how was the environment for you? The Muslim community that you grew up with, the friends and people that you went to school with, how are they like? What do they believe in? How well integrated they are into the society, et cetera? Because I think for me, it's pretty fascinating to hear about Muslims in the UK.
Okay, so going to school, we went to a school where we were the only Muslim children at the school. There was bullying at first, and then they accepted us. They were quick to accept us. We were accepted. And then I went to high school, which was mixed. There was quite a lot of Muslim, Pakistani, Indian people there. I found it quite difficult to be accepted by the Pakistani girls. They called me half-caste, mongrel, all sorts of names because my mum was white. And eventually I made friends. But I remember coming home from high school and asking my dad if I could, and most of my friends were white, if I could go and hang out with them at the weekend and stuff. And my dad said, no, we don't mix with white people. They're not good. Remembering my mum's white. So always in the back of my head was, you know, my mum's white. And then I made friends with some Indian girls and came home and said to my dad, okay, I've got these friends, these Sikh girls. And my dad said, no, 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 no. You know, they're not good friends. But we weren't allowed out. We weren't allowed out after school. We weren't allowed out at the weekend. We came home from school. We went to mosque for a couple of hours. And at the weekend, we just stayed at home. The only place we could go was the library. And that's where I got my love of books. So we weren't allowed to integrate. We were discouraged from integrating.
Mm-hmm. You're in a Sunni Muslim household or Shia?
My dad never ever told us what we were. He just always used to say we were Muslims, but I think we must be Sunni because we're not Shiites. Yeah, we don't
kind of sounds like it because, you know, yeah. Shias do not do this. No, I'm kidding. Shias are pretty easy to talk to Armin. So I think Fessel brought up something that's really interesting to me. And even if we look at this group here, clearly it's just a sample size of five, and this is anecdotal. But, you know, Fessel came from Iraq, Armin from Iran, me from Pakistan, and all three of us had sort of very more liberal type of families. Whereas, you know, Yaz lived in Vancouver and her family was super conservative. And it seems that you also had a very similar sort of conservative upbringing, and you guys were, you know, born and raised in Western countries. And I noticed this when I first came here, and I saw this pattern that when I was in Pakistan over there, people wanted to become more Western. You know, they were trying to I'm talking about the regular middle class people, right? Mm-hmm. They're trying to get like Western education. They're trying to learn English. They're listening to, you know, English music and Hollywood movies and, you know, things like that. And then when we came here, we saw that the Pakistanis who had moved here from there a while ago, they were trying to find their own, get in touch with their roots, and they're all eating halal meat. A lot of the immigrants actually didn't. The immigrants came here like, hey, I used to have McDonald's there. I'm fucking having McDonald's here, you know? But the ones born and raised here, like, no, I'm just going to have the fillet of fish and, you know, stuff like that. And so I noticed that a lot, that there was this effort to try and stick to your roots once you're here. And the more Western you get, like the people who party the most when they're younger, or, you know, the people who marry a white woman, or whatever it is, then, you know, once there's a sort of guilt when they have their own kids. They're like, okay, now I'm going to double down and go back. Did you notice anything like that?
I can remember my dad's brother coming over from Pakistan. I must have been about 9 or 10. He came over to visit, and this was his first mm-hmm. visit to the UK. And we'd obviously gone, he'd maybe just noticed a few days, and he'd said to my dad, do you not let them do anything? Mm-hmm. My dad was like, what do you mean? And he's like, do you not let them go to the cinema with their friends? Do you not let them go out? And he was like, no, 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 no. And my uncle couldn't understand that. He'd come over from Pakistan, and he couldn't understand that we were living in the West, but we weren't allowed to be part of it, sort mm-hmm. of thing. So yeah, I don't know. I don't know why they did that.
I find it interesting that you said that your upbringing was moderate, sort of, and now once you talk about it more, it doesn't sound very moderate. The fact, like, I don't know, compared to Faisal and yeah. Armin and Ali's upbringings, I think they were probably allowed to be friends with non-Muslim people, and they're probably allowed to go out. And I don't know if your sisters were not forced into arranged marriages. Like, it sounds like a bit more conservative.
Yeah, I think my stepsister, I think being the Gori's daughter, there was a lot more, there was more strictness on us, because I think my mum worried as well quite a lot that, you know, if we did anything or if we were caught doing anything, people would say, oh, it's because she's the Gori's daughter.
I find it fascinating that you were accepted more by the Western kids more than the Pakistani or the Muslim kids. Like, yeah. A lot of people here are always worried about Muslims not being accepted, but I think they don't see the other side of it, where Muslims don't accept a lot of people in their own communities. But in one thing you mentioned that you were not brave enough to stand up against to your dad. What would your dad do if you did, you know, speak openly against him or defied him or anything like that?
Slap you.
Holy shit. Really?
Yeah. So you learned from a young age not to.
Were you ever abused like that?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I mean, I sorry to sound very ignorant here, because I mean, as I said, like, for me, I didn't grow up in the West, but you said like slapping and domestic violence and stuff. How are the services in the UK? Like, did you know that you are able to call police or 911 or? Like, how is it, like, if someone is facing domestic violence, can they report to the authorities?
Now they can. Yeah, now they can, I suppose. But back then, you know, I don't know if you've heard of Childline, but, you know, Childline was set up when I was 16 to help white children. And I remember phoning Childline and they didn't have a clue. They didn't understand the culture. And I remember running away, going to the police. The police said they couldn't help, made enough noise. And, you know, we were to go back the next day and speak to a social worker. The social worker was Pakistani. The social worker was not interested in what we had to say. You know, we're going to get, I remember saying to the social worker, they're going to send me to Pakistan. They're going to send, get me married to an old man. And he was like, yeah, whatever. You know, you're going back home.
So that's a lot like Yaz, your experience where you went through all these, well, I mean, the horrific things, like from, you know, what I've read of what you've written. And, you know, you went and you actually, you went to court too, right? You had a hearing and you told them all of this stuff and they just said, that's just your culture. And this is in Vancouver in Canada.
That's correct. Yeah. So very similar to Shazia's story. They didn't know what to do with my situation. They felt like, well, for me, they said it was, I don't know if this is the same for you, Shazia, but for me, they said, so corporal punishment isn't against the law in Canada. You're allowed to hit your children. But obviously the way I was being hit was not normal being hit, but who are they to judge what's normal? You know, cultural sensitivity, and everybody is, you know, from different cultures, they hit their kids in different ways, and they didn't want to be judgmental of different cultures. So they said, sorry, you have to go back. You have to go back to the house to live with a man that you just finished taking to court. So, yeah.
That's amazing.
Can I just point out, that the people that usually accuse us of being racist are usually the same people that mention that everybody has their own culture. These are the people that are saying that it's not okay for a Western or a white family to hit their wife or children, but it's okay mm-hmm. for a Pakistani or an Egyptian family to hit their children. This is the racist thing to say, because they say like women in Pakistan are less deserving of human rights than women in Canada or United States. And mm-hmm. when we point out that this is Islam or culture doesn't make this okay, we are the ones that are usually being labeled as racist, whereas their position is a racist one, that some people with lower culture are okay. We should be okay with them treating their women and children like this.
Yeah, it's a bigotry of low expectations. That's what it is. And, you know, I would say this, if I walked around here in Toronto and I put my wife in a burqa and my daughter in a burqa, and I walked around, they'd look at me as a brown man. They'd be like, oh, you know, it's just culture. You got to respect it. That's how they are. But if a white man did the same thing here, you know, he'd never hear the end of it. And that actually isn't respect for cultures. It's not respect for diversity. It's not a celebration of diversity. That's actually straight up racism. And that the liberal left actually engages in often. So.
Totally agree. I just watched a movie by Dia Khan, which I don't.
Oh, yeah.
Islam Nonbelievers?
No, well, that is by Dia Khan too, but this one is called Benaz, A Love Story.
Oh,
and it's
yeah.
exactly what Armin was describing and what Shazia and I are describing. Benaz went to the police 5 different times saying, I'm afraid for my life. She was afraid that her family was going to kill her. Same thing. She was forced into an arranged marriage, just like we were. And she left, she got away from him, went back with her family. And that's dishonorable, right? Because now the man that they had married her to was a really important man. The father-in-law, her father was calling him the David Beckham of son-in-laws. He was so proud to have him as a son-in-law. So for his daughter to leave this man was such a smear on their family. And on top of that, she actually had a boyfriend. So she knew that they were out to kill her. And 5 different occasions, she went to the police giving them explicit, like such specific and like details about the plan. And the system completely failed her because of exactly what Armin was describing. They were like, eh, whatever. Like, that's brown people. That's the way they are. You know, their culture is like that. They're just a little bit more heavy handed and she'll be fine. And she wasn't fine. She was murdered by her family.
Yeah, Shazia, I just wanted to ask, there's a, and this may have been around the time that you were growing up, but that movie East is East, you know, when I hear your story, I thought of that movie, which was, I mean, it was a fantastic
movie. That was amazing. That was absolutely amazing.
So I wanted to, so just for people who don't know, East is East was about a family. It was sort of similar to Shazia's. It took place in Bradford, which is a community in England that is largely South Asian and largely Muslim. And it was basically a Pakistani man who was married to a white woman who he used to abuse all the time. And he had six or seven kids, and they were caught in the middle. They were all, you know, the mother was Gori, just like, you know, the situation you described. And there was this thing where he wanted them to become more and more Pakistani, and they were having trouble with it. It's a great movie if you can go out and you can watch it. When you saw that, so you reacted and you said it was amazing.
Yeah,
does that mean that there were parts of it that you related to?
Yeah, of course. It was like our home, only my dad called wife number one over. He always threatened that he was going to bring wife number one over. Yeah, we absolutely loved it. Just to see similar, you know, like I said, you identify, and just to have the mixed race characters and the Pakistani dad and the little Catholic mom. So yeah, it was really good.
Yeah. And another thing I just wanted to, just a little follow-up thing before we go to Faisal, is I assume it's your ex-husband. You're not in that marriage anymore?
No.
Okay. So and what happened with that? How did you leave?
I just reached my breaking point, I suppose, one day. It was a really violent, horrible time. It was the only time in my life where I've ever, ever seriously thought about committing suicide, because it would have been just hell. It's the only way I can describe it. And I just reached breaking point one day, and just something really silly. He had friends over and spoke to me really, really just the way he always spoke to me. And his friend had said that, you know, that's your wife, treat her with a little bit of respect. And just somebody saying something like that, I think. And I left the next day and went to a homeless unit.
Wow. So are you in touch with anybody in your family at all? Mm. Siblings or
just
anything?
Just one brother.
One brother?
Yeah.
Okay. And did he also have a similar experience where, you know, he also left, or?
Yeah, he's left as well. But he's in touch with, like, my mum and siblings on my mum's side. He's not in touch with my dad.
Armin is asking, left where? Because I was really fascinated by this community that you were describing of all Pakistanis when you were growing up in Scotland, so much so that when you left your marriage and got away from your family, you had trouble integrating into Scottish society, which is weird because you're born and raised there, but you're in your little Pakistani bubble.
Yeah. So and my mindset is I'm Pakistani. I'm a Pakistani person. I'm a Pakistani girl. I was never allowed to explore the white side or be proud of being white. That was always, you know, you were just Pakistan. Even though you were always the Gori's daughter, even though you were always known as the Gori's daughter, I was raised Pakistani to try and integrate into the white society, because when my dad disowned me, the entire community disowned me. You're not welcome. You know, if my dad's not talking to me, I can't go to one of his, you know, I can't go to my uncle's house, or I can't go to friends in the community, because it's my dad's honour, isn't it? He's disowned me, so I'm not welcome anywhere.
Have you ever been to Pakistan?
I lived in Pakistan for 4 years. I went years. When I was three and came back when I was seven, eight. Yeah, uh-huh. So four, 5 years I was over there. I lived in Mirpur.
Could you just elaborate a little bit about that community you were talking about? So it's not just, so the community was actually like the stores that you went to, the restaurants, the school, the shopping, like everything was all Pakistani all the time, all around you?
Yeah.
Because that's not something that I'm familiar with. So I was just hoping you could tell us a little bit about what that's like.
Everything's Pakistani, so you weren't really allowed out anywhere. So the only place we were allowed out was other relatives' homes. So you weren't really allowed to go and hang out anywhere, or you were never alone. that what you mean? So
no, like, did it feel like you were in a country within a country? Did it feel like you were like in a little mini Pakistan?
A little ghetto, yeah, yeah. The area that we grew up in is known as Little Pakistan. In Glasgow, it's called Little Pakistan. It's mostly people from Mirpur in the area. So yeah, everything around me was Pakistani. Yeah.
Okay, Faisal, you had a question.
Yeah, so my question is, from the time that you grew up and the time as we speak in 2017, do you see any differences in the community? Do you see the community turning more liberal, more conservative? Is the extremism going there? All of these issues surrounding domestic violence and women's rights and stuff, is it still the case or has it changed for the better?
I think it's better in one way, that there's more help available and they take honour violence more seriously. It's a criminal offence in the UK now. In Scotland, it's a criminal offence to force your child into a marriage. So there's help available in that way. But I would say it's becoming more conservative. When I was growing up, when I went to high school, there was one girl that wore a hijab and we all felt really sorry for her. Just the one girl. We had to wear a scarf around your neck, you know, and you'd go into Little Pakistan and it'd be really colourful. Everybody would have the shalwar kameez on, they'd be bright, colourful, whereas now it just seems to be lots of really black hijabs.
Just like in Pakistan, I guess, is the same thing happening, because I remember Obaid was saying it's like that in Pakistan now.
Yeah, that's happening.
I mean, that's something that really concerns me. Like, because I actually have relatives living in the UK. I mean, my sister lives in the UK. I have probably other relatives live there. And it's, I've seen that there was this documentary. I mean, Islam Nonbelievers is one of them, about ex-Muslims. And also there was a documentary by PBS called Terror in Europe. And okay. They were talking about extremism around the United Kingdom and Europe in general. And
that's a great documentary.
It's intense. It's insane, like to see, like, London and Manchester and Glasgow and Edinburgh and all these places that in my opinion, like, coming from Iraq, like, these are the places I wanted to grow up in. Like, like I one of the things that I actually all because my parents studied in the my dad studied in the UK, and he was offered British citizenship. And he refused, and when he went back to Iraq, and I still scold my dad until today, why did he leave the UK and go back to Iraq? And hearing some of the stories, like, I tell my dad, like, I love you, Dad, but I think you fucked up. Like, I think you really fucked up here.
And now you're happy.
But it's really interesting, like, to hear stories like yours, Shazia, and others in places like the United Kingdom, which I place that I actually love, like, I want to visit, I would like to see, and most of my Western values, for the lack of a better word, come from the United Kingdom. Adam Smith and John Stuart Mill and the intellectuals of the Enlightenment all come from that place. And it's really interesting to see, I mean, it's kind of interesting in a bad way, but, like, it's interesting to see these stories of conservatism and extremism.
Yeah, I'm just really curious to know how did you manage to survive by yourself with no connections, and did you have, like, your own money? How did you manage to survive if you had no family support or if you didn't have anywhere to go?
We have benefits, so I was able to claim benefits because I was on my own, which is not a lot, but it was still better than nothing. And I really struggled. Not financially. I think I struggled more emotionally to go from always having people around you to never being alone. Because as a Pakistani girl, you aren't ever alone unless you're in bed sleeping or in the bathroom. There's always people around you. To go from that to be sitting in a flat on my own with nobody. And I think I became really intense with a lot of friends because I would make friends and I would want them to become my family.
And now you're reaching out to people, you're writing. What makes you want to do that? Like, what motivates you to try to talk to more people about your experience?
to let other people know that, one, that they're not alone, and two, that it does get easier.
Can you tell us a little bit about the work that you do?
I work with the Halo Project, who are a national charity. They raise awareness on forced marriage, FGM, honour-based violence. The reason why I love the Halo Project is it's brilliant to help people and to get them to leave a forced marriage. It's the aftercare that's really important, you know, because when you leave that forced marriage, the majority of times you're going to be leaving everything that's familiar behind you, and then you're going to be on your own. So the Halo Project provides loads of different things. They have like coffee mornings, running clubs, the Halo Hope Programme, just lots of different things so that women and men that are leaving are not on their own. Because it's the loneliness and the isolation that almost made me go back so many times and just marry another unsuitable man from Pakistan. Because sometimes, some days, that would have been better than being on my own.
And that's why you hear of suicide quite often for people that leave their religions, their community. Because when you talk about, like, there's, it's against the law now to force a girl into a marriage, but what are that girl, like, what are her choices? You know, sure, it's against the law, but then what? Yeah. And she'll be completely disowned, and yeah, she'll have to be, you know, start from scratch. She'll have absolutely no support or resources. Like, it's really, really hard to for people to imagine what that's like. Like, you know what that's like. I know what that's like. But how do you describe that to somebody?
And people don't understand as well that your parents could be loving. They could be kind. But this is their tradition that they force you into a marriage. So then how do you go about jailing your parents for this? You know, do you want to see your parents jailed?
That's a good point.
Because somebody had asked me as well, and I had said, you know, if I was 18 today and my parents were forcing me into marriage, would I want to see my parents jailed? Because, you know.
Mm-hmm. I think I would have been happy seeing my mother's husband jailed. I'd had no problem. But even after all of the horrible things my mom has done, including threatening my life, not just threatening my life, but like legitimately, like I think this is another thing with the people learn from watching Benaz, a love story that I mentioned, or hearing your story or my story or so many other women's stories. In the Muslim community, when a girl says, my parents threatened to kill me, it's not like, my parents are going to kill me.
Yeah.
It's like legitimately honor killings are like, you know, 3,000 to 5,000 a year in the UK alone. So it's not like it's just an empty threat.
That's what worries me as well. That's what we know, you know, with honour killings, you're not going to report your daughter missing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when I got taken to Pakistan as well, like I was away for 4 or 5 years, you just go back home. You know, you're going back home.
That's what my mom actually would say that to me. She'd say, I'm going to send you to Egypt and I'll kill you, and I can just say she's gone to Egypt.
And who's going to check?
And these are the days before Facebook or email or internet or anything, so that's it.
So who's going to check? You've gone back home. So how many girls, it worries me, I try not to think about it. And I think, how many girls are buried in the UK that have been sent back home?
That's the work that you do, though, is to support these girls to make sure that that doesn't happen to as many girls as you can.
Mm-hmm.
Can we actually get the name of, what was the name of the project again? I just want to make sure if people were interested, they know where to find it.
Halo, H-A-L-O.
Halo.
Halo Project.
H-A-L-O.
And they have a website? Is it a UK-based project or is it a worldwide?
Yes.
Okay. Halo Project.
I remember you were telling me that part of your role is to support, is to train people that support these girls?
To train safeguarding agencies. Yeah.
So tell me, what's a safeguarding agency? What does that mean?
Safeguarding agencies like the police, social workers, anybody that might be in contact with the girls.
Is it really that different from a regular girl? Is abuse really that different in a Muslim household versus a Scottish household?
It can be, I suppose, yeah. You know, because I have a daughter, so if my daughter becomes, you know, she's a teenager, she's 15, 16, and she comes in and she says, Mum, I'm going out. I've met a boy and we're going to go out on a date. I'm not going to beat her. So in that sense, the abuse is different. you know, because
correct,
Pakistani girls are beaten again for becoming westernized because parents can't control them.
Right. But I mean, like, I think about myself when I was, you know, 13 or 14 years old. And if I'm going to the social workers and I'm telling them I'm being beaten and I'm showing them my bruises, what the fuck does it matter where my family is originally from? Right? A kid is in front of you covered in bruises and telling you, I want to go to foster care. Like, when does a kid ever say, I want to go to foster care? So I feel like why do they feel like it's something different? Have you gotten any insight from the work that you do? Like, why are girls from?
I personally think this has nothing to do with work. This is my personal opinion on it, that a lot of it comes down to they're scared. They're scared of being called racist. They're scared of possible riots, you know, so they just let it go.
Possibly. So typical story.
Yeah. The fear of being called racist is far more important than protecting girls that are getting beaten, girls that are getting forced into marriages, girls that are getting cut.
Wow.
That's like Rotterdam. Is that the name of the town?
Rotherham.
What is it?
Rotherham.
I think it was Rotherham.
Rotherham. That's where the 1,400 girls or something were.
Yeah, there's just another one as well somewhere. I seen the other day. That's it there, Rotherham.
But just to point out that this means that it works. This means this means that they are winning this battle. Their fear tactics, their Islamophobia accusation, their racist accusation. This is a proven tactic that gives results. And look what it's doing, right?
And we're the ones that are screwed in this situation, right? Like, you don't get, it's okay, don't call me an Islamophobe. Rape her, kill her, shove her in a suitcase, bury her 6 feet under. Yeah. Just don't call me a racist.
Yeah. I'll sleep easy tonight knowing that I'm not a racist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what's important.
Can I ask a question? I mean, that's probably could be related to work. Do you have any statistics or numbers about the cases that you're talking about? Like, how common is domestic violence or in these communities that you're mentioning?
It's really, really common. And I think, you know, there's something as well that not a lot of people touch on. So a lot of people that go to get help, you know, so a girl comes for help because she wants to leave her forced marriage, or a girl comes for help because she's going to be forced into a marriage. And then you scratch the surface and another huge taboo subject that never, ever gets discussed is the child sex abuse that happens in our community. You know, nobody talks about that because it's just a taboo subject, I think, in all communities, not just Pakistanis. And then people will say to you, oh, it doesn't happen in Pakistani communities. There's no stats. There's no stats because nobody tells.
Yeah. It's like nobody gets raped in Saudi Arabia either because there's no stats, or in the UAE.
Yeah.
And that, of course, is because in Sharia law countries, there has to be 4 witnesses to the penetration. Otherwise, the woman that claims that she was raped is a liar, and then she can go to prison for defamation of character. So nobody reports it, no reports, no stats. Rape-free country.
I want to just bring up a really quick point here is that you hear this thing going around about Sweden being the rape capital of the world. And the only reason for that is because women in Sweden are feel more comfortable being able to go up and report. Right, because they know that they have a better chance of getting some sort of justice. And also the laws for rape, what is classified as a rape in Sweden, is it's much more stringent. You know, obviously Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, India has a huge rape epidemic. I mean, these countries have much higher rampant rates of rape. It's essentially part of the culture. When you talk about rape culture, I mean, that's where it is in those places. But you know, you can't, like, if something happens to you in Saudi Arabia, you can't report because as Yaz said, if a woman goes up and says, I was raped, and she doesn't have four male witnesses who witnessed the act of penetration to prove it, she will be accused of falsely accusing the man, and then she will end up getting 200 lashes and getting a jail sentence. So when people just loosely throw around these statistics, like Sweden is the rape capital of the world, that there's a lot of context and a huge story behind it that they just completely ignore. They're completely ignorant of.
May I ask a question? I mean, I know that you work in the non-profit world and charities, and I don't want to take a position from you that is you don't want to talk about. But how much do you think that the Muslim organizations in the UK, like, I don't know the name of the Muslim organizations, maybe like the Muslim Council of Britain, CARE, ISNA, whatever the names are in the UK, okay. how much do you think they are responsible for creating the culture that allows this abuse to happen without going reported or punished?
And do they help these girls? Are they helping the Hill Project?
Are they helping you?
Are they supporting the Muslim girls? Are they? Because that's supposed to be their job, right?
These Muslim males? The community leaders? No, I think
like Linda Sarsour, for example, does she give a shit about Muslim women that are being...
No. So there is no help, like the organizations that are like CARE and ISNA and Muslim Council of Britain and stuff, they don't do anything to help cases like this.
Oh, God, I'm probably going to get a fatwa against me or something, but they probably hindered it. They're probably the ones that make it worse. Like, think about it. My dad came over in the 60s. So I got married, forced into marriage, the late 80s, 1988, I was forced into marriage, and 2017, we have all these different organisations to help women leave forced marriage, to help women escape forced marriage, to end FGM, to stop honour-based violence, and all these years have gone past, and all they do is talk to the men. Where are the women in all of this? You know, where are the women leaders in the Muslim community? It's like the women's, you know, you hear about the Labour Party in the UK, and women will talk, you know, I've read loads of different things about women that try and make change, and these Muslim men threaten them and just shut down their voices. So no, these CARE and Muslim Council of Britain are just not helping at all. No,
in fact, they're making it worse.
Of course they are. And the white people, you know, the white society isn't helping either, because the Muslim vote counts. The Muslim vote counts more than helping vulnerable women and men and children.
So it all comes down to politics, right? Like it says I'm going to pander to these community leaders, blah, 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 and then I'm going to discount all the grievances of the women within these communities or the minorities in these communities, because that's what it takes to... And I'm afraid that we're witnessing something similar in the United States, in which you see, I mean, Bernie Sanders, who is supposedly the candidate for president of the United States, hired someone like Linda Sarsour to be his campaign manager in New York and around this country, because I think, I mean, she helped him, as far as I know, is that she helped him win the Michigan votes, because that's where many Muslims live in the state of Michigan. So eventually they try to ignore all the grievances for people like you and Yasmin in that regard, because that's what it takes to get the vote. I mean, that's kind of very... It's a very ugly side of the world, right? It's a very ugly side of reality.
Shazia, I have a question, actually, that just popped into my head. So we were talking about Rotherham, and we're talking about how things are really bad in the UK, and you're not getting any support from the Muslim groups. In fact, they're hindering it, and politicians don't really care because they're just worried about votes. What about, what are your thoughts on Tommy Robinson and the fact that he's trying to,
okay.
How do
yeah,
you?
Yeah, this is This is where it'll get now funny, because your smear, the minute you even mention his name, you are Hitler. You know, if you even say anything about him.
Tommy Robinson is Hitler.
I avoided Tommy Robinson for the longest of times because I grew up with racism. I grew up with niggers go home, painted on our garden wall, window smashed, spat in the street. My mum was called a packy lover. The British National Party, you know, so Tommy Robinson set up the English Defence League. So I avoided him. Yeah, he was a racist. I didn't want to know. And then I started speaking to somebody and they sent me like links to different YouTube like talks he had done. And I started thinking, right, wait a minute here. This is a man that was talking about grooming gangs before anybody else was speaking about grooming gangs. So, and the radicalization that was going on in prisons, he was talking about all these things he was talking about back then that we're all now talking about, but he was called the racist, he was smeared. And so you have like somebody like Majid Nawaz who was an extremist and he's now one of the good guys and it seems like he can be forgiven and it's okay. But you have somebody like Tommy Robinson who set up the EDL, who went to one BNP meeting, I think, but he's never ever forgiven for that. And it's just double standards, the double standards that I don't understand, that it's almost like if you're white working class, you will never ever be forgiven. You will always be racist. You will always be a bigot. But if you're brown and you're Muslim and you did something wrong and you've changed your views, then everybody's going to love you. And it's this, the double standards that I don't understand. And I follow Tommy Robinson and he follows me on Twitter.
And I think that's something we can all relate to. Like, we all speak out against Islam in our lives and we've all dealt with smears of bigot, racist. But I think, like you said, it can fall off of us a lot easier than it can fall off of a straight white man, right?
Yeah.
Once he gets smeared as bigot and racist, nobody cares to look any further. Somebody smears me as a bigot and a racist, they're going to be like, hang on a minute, but she's brown skin and she comes from an Arab family and she's an ex-Muslim. That can't be right.
Some people will
give me a second chance.
No. Some people will just say, because I've been told I'm deluded.
Oh, you're Uncle Tom.
I'm brainwashed.
Native informant.
Yeah.
Coconut.
Zionist show. But I mean, that's sure what you just mentioned. I mean, I know Armin has a question, but I just want to make a comment before Armin makes a question. Is that the failure of the left, the extreme failure of the left, not just a simple failure, is an extreme failure of the left, has made heroes out of Tommy Robinson. I mean, I just to be honest with you, I don't really have that much respect for people mm-hmm. like Tommy Robinson, but the fact that he became a savior, because we are like poor, people, right? We went through so much discrimination and hatred, and we look at for people like Tommy Robinson to help us because of the extreme failure of the left, the fact that they sided with people who kill us.
Yep.
They sided with people who discriminate against us. They sided with people who would put women to face female genital mutilation and they're not mm-hmm. going to report it because out of fear of racism. The left is on the side of people who want to kill us, to the way that yeah. it made people like Tom Robinson and maybe Geert Wilders and all yeah. of these people to sound,
allies now.
To kind of make them sound like allies, because the left has sided with the people who want to kill us. It's not just because I have like some disagreements.
Yeah,
with
I agree with that 100%.
Yeah, like I like people say, oh, you're being too hard on the left. But no, the left has sided with people who want to kill me. They sided with Islamists. They supported the Muslim Brotherhood. These are not just different point of view. This is our people who are doing damage to all of us. And Shazia is definitely one of the people who have been obviously damaged by the some of the acts being done. And I just wanted to send this message to the people who are on the left who are listening to us, is that just so you know, you sided with the people who discriminate against Shazia, discriminate against Yasmin, discriminate against Ali, Armin, and sided with the people who want to kill us.
It's important that they don't just discriminate against ex-Muslims and want to kill ex-Muslims, but going back to what Shazia was saying, they discriminate against Muslims as well, and they throw Muslims under the bus. They don't even care because it's all about saving face, right?
Exactly. So,
they don't honor killings. And
it's more important not to be called a racist than actually save a woman's life or save a minority within a minority. And I just wanted to make this comment because I think it's mostly ignored because people say, oh, you're being too judgmental on the left, or I've been kind of harsh on the left. No, I don't think I'm being harsh. I think that you guys have thrown us under the bus and you want to side with the people who want to kill us. Maybe you don't want to kill us directly, but you want to side with the people who want to kill us, or you throw us under the bus just because you don't want to be called racist, or you think it's the left betrayal of all of us. It's a betrayal. It's not a different point of view.
I think when I was telling Faisal this earlier, like ISIS and Al-Qaeda and everything, they've already won. I mean, they wanted to create this clash of civilizations between, you know, Muslims and the West and Western people and Muslims. And, you know, the thing is that the moment you decide not to speak up, like Shazia, you were saying that people don't want to be called racist. They don't want to be called Islamophobic. They're scared of that. They don't want to reprint the cartoons that, you know, 15 people at Charlie Hebdo got killed over. They don't want to do that because they think that it'll increase terrorism. It'll radicalize people. Well, the thing is, the moment you decide not to do that, the moment you cower down and the left does this, you are already a victim of terrorism. That is how terrorism mm-hmm. works. And the fact that they've made you too scared to take the right side, where, you know, if Donald Trump says something misogynistic, you're going to slam him. But, you know, if a Muslim says something misogynistic, you have to stand back and respect it because you're too scared to be Islamophobic. That is, you are already a victim of terrorism if you've done that, because you are already scared to speak out.
You are supporting terrorism. You are supporting terrorism.
Yeah. You're helping and you're, it out. You are a victim of it too. So, I mean, these are, in this case, like just the fact that, especially when I see the polarization, I think it's very clear that terrorism does work. And the regressive left is actually proof of that, that it does work. Armin, you had a question?
Well, before I ask my question, I just want to point out that sometimes people point out that because the left has betrayed us, the right is the only place some of us can go. But I think that's not true. I think what we are doing here with this podcast, with our books, is that mm-hmm. we're showing that we could create our own home. We don't need the right or the left. We create our own platform and our own media, and we find our own way to reach out to people. We don't need any of those people. Mm-hmm. But
and can I add something to that? Just to one thing is that I think that this whole idea that I don't want to, just because, you know, I have this problem with you know, Islam, or just because I have a problem with all of these things that are happening, you know, I don't want my ally to be a Bible thumper, you know, a Quran burning guy, or some like far right wing guy who comes up. He's like, yeah, you know, like I have a problem with Islam too.
I have no problem with Quran burning, by the way. It's just, I mean, it's just other than environmental issues and pollution, I don't have any problem.
I know, but the problem, that's fine. But like just the idea that there is all these Bible thumpers, right? The fact that the guy who's burning the Quran is actually himself a Bible thumper. He's like, no, this delusion is better. You know, my stupidity is way better, and I'm coming to you. And then you people actually go and ally with him because, you know, they have a problem with Islam, so they ally with him. And that's a big issue.
I have the meth cocaine analogy, in which like someone says meth is bad, but cocaine is better.
Yeah, it's just
actually,
it's
which is actually true. I mean, for those of us who tried cocaine, it's actually quite better.
But
of course, that was in a different country, right? It wasn't here.
All right, but let me ask my what do you, everybody here, how do you guys respond to people that say this, you know, this abuse of women and mistreatment of women has nothing to do with Islam? This is an Iraqi problem or a Pakistani problem or an Iranian problem. This is a cultural, local problem. This is in Islam. In Islam, women have a high position. They mention that there's one saying that the heaven is under the feet of mother or something like that. And she has pointed out to Fatima as a very honored lady, or Sonny's pointed out to, I guess, Aisha, or both of them pointed out to Khadija as this first Muslim after Muhammad, and how important she was in Islam and how well-respected she was. And they say this has nothing to do with the teaching of Islam. This is Muslims doing bad things. It's not Muslims following Islam correctly. So they say, how would you respond to people that claim that?
Can I come in to that one?
Yeah, Shazia, it's okay. For you, actually.
Okay, I always find it really interesting when people say that, you know, it's culture, and you think, okay, so culture from Iraq, Egypt, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, all over the world, the UK. And the only thing that is common in all of them is our religion. It's the religion, it's Islam that's common. You know, the culture in Egypt is going to be different from the culture in Pakistan, and the culture in Pakistan is going to be different from the culture in Canada. The thing that is the common denominator for all of it is Islam.
Ali, do you have a response? Ali and Yas, do you have a response to that? I'm really interested to see what you guys would say.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I actually wrote about this in my book. I don't think it's necessarily in the Quran. There's a very clear verse, Surah 4, verse 34, that allows men to beat women and establishes male authority over women and uses that as justification for men to beat women. And this is these are words that you know, most Muslims consider to be the word of God, even if, and unfortunately a lot of them practice it more than we would want. But in addition to that, even beyond that, I think Abrahamic religion overall has always tried to suppress women. I mean, there's a, you know, when you talk about men having physical power, right? They have physical, that's always like, you know, men are physically strong. Everybody talks about it. But when it comes to female sexuality, which is also a very, very powerful force in the human species, you know, that's something that's always been kept down. And one of the worst things that's happened is, and I feel that there's a connection, is with Mary and Jesus. The fact that Mary was a virgin, and she was immaculately conceived. And because she was a virgin, you know, and she gave birth, that means she was pure and she was chaste and she was innocent. You know, as if, God forbid, if you ever came close to a man, you would be impure or unchaste, or, you know, or you wouldn't be innocent anymore. And people even talk of loss of innocence and loss of virginity when you're actually really gaining something in these processes. So whenever you have a mindset like that, that associates, that sort of fetishizes virginity and restricts like the honor of a woman, or, you know, whatever it is, to her, essentially her vagina, that's connected to things like female genital mutilation. That's connected to domestic abuse. That's connected to keeping women down and not having them speak. That's connected to them trying to cover up their attraction so that, you know, with the hijab and the burqa, or even in other Abrahamic religions, like, you know, Hasidic Judaism, with Hasidic Jews and even Christians, fundamentalist Christians. You know, just the fact that this is considered a virtue. Mike Pence, actually, just yesterday, is the vice president of the United States, said that he doesn't have alcohol or dinner with any woman who's not his wife. And, you know, that's supposed to be something that's very virtuous. And, you know, he's a good man, good believing man, because he doesn't have dinner with anybody but his wife and doesn't have alcohol. But the thing is, what he's saying is that he can't control himself. Mm-hmm. He's like, he's just, there's no other woman that he can actually look at and have dinner and wine with, you know, without potentially thinking of some sort of sexual connection. And that's a perversion that is directly connected to his religious beliefs. So I think that mindset itself just naturally lends itself to things like domestic violence. I think that Islam is basically plagiarized from Judaism and Christianity. And it comes from that. And all it does is it cements it. And it's just made it, you know, even more like robust as a tradition. And the quote I'm going to end with here is something I saw on Reddit, is someone who says that it's culture, not religion. That's like saying, you know, it wasn't falling out of a plane that hit, that killed you. It was the ground, right? They're the same thing.
And to continue on with the culture versus religion thing, I think that when you're born and raised in countries like Muslim majority countries, like Pakistan, Egypt, Indonesia, blah, 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 maybe the culture and the religion sort of meld into each other and it's difficult to separate the two. But for people like Shazia and I that grew up in non-Muslim majority countries, and then we also had a Muslim upbringing, we can see the vast chasm between culture and religion. And we can see that it's, you know, there is nothing similar between Canadian culture for me and Islamic religion. They are completely two different stratospheres. So this mixing of culture and religion thing that people do quite often is maybe they have trouble discerning, but it's very clear that all of these themes that are similar in my life, similar in Shazia's life, similar in Banaz's life, similar in, oh my God, millions and millions of girls' lives I speak to from all over the world. All of these things we talked about, right? Like domestic violence, forced marriages, you know, in some cases, FGM, and all of these common themes are all from the religion. None of them come from any of these cultures. The fact that the cultures now sort of have them in there, it came from religion because religion informed the culture. Obviously, culture and religion inform each other. But if you look at a culture like Canadian culture, Scottish culture, you'll find that those things don't exist there. And then it just highlights how it's most definitely coming from the religious side of things.
Yeah. I mean, someone like Linda Sarsour would tell you that I am American Muslim, and these two identities don't contradict each other, right?
So they most definitely do.
Like to say, like, what is an American culture? What is a Muslim culture? They both can be, how to say, go hand in hand. Like someone can be an American Muslim, not Muslim only or American only, but American Muslim or Scottish Muslim or I don't know. Canadian Muslim. So I don't know, like, whether this words like Canadian culture. I mean, what is Canadian culture? What is American culture?
So Canadian culture is an American culture. These are secular values. So when we're talking about like liberal values, like free speech and freedom of from religion, freedom of religion, we're talking about equality of the sexes. We're talking about gay rights. We're talking all of these things are against Islam. None of these things have a problem, like, you know what I mean? What was Linda Sarsour's point? I can't remember. I've been drinking too much wine, but you said they don't contradict each other. They all That's contradict each other. Democracy in and of itself contradicts Islam.
And we didn't ever identify as Muslims when I was growing up. We were just Scottish or Pakistani. We were Pakistani people. And it just seems recently the Muslim identity has gotten really strong. Like loads of people now identify as being British Muslim or Scottish Muslim, whereas before it was just we were Pakistani people.
I think it's the North American culture, especially Canada and the US, is really interesting because there's so much immigration involved. So when you look at a lot of the nation states, you know, they have a national dress, they have traditional music, they have traditional cuisine and all of that. But you come to the U.S. and Canada, it's like there's jeans and there's McDonald's and, you know, Coca-Cola. I mean, the rock and roll, you know, it's stuff like that. It isn't there. It's a constantly evolving thing. When you think of cultural elements that have sort of been permanent here or that are traditional, you know, they don't really go back more than 50 or 60 years and they're constantly changing. And I think that's another thing about culture is culture can evolve. Religion dogmatizes culture. It freezes culture in place. And that's what's so toxic about religion. And when you have this amalgamation of religion and culture is that, you know, you have a naturally evolving culture as time moves on. You know, you have, you know, like what you were saying, the secular values came in that had a huge impact on the culture, printing press, technology, all of these things. But then when you add religion in the mix, that prevents that every step of the way. And you look at it, I mean, with Islam, it's obvious. Even if you look at other religions, like in Catholicism, women's rights, gay rights, you know, Galileo, all of they slowed everything down by decades, all of this progress that was happening, whether it was in science or civil rights or anything. So this is a huge problem with, yes, there are culture and religion do mix, but when they do, it's very toxic and it slows down the natural evolution of how cultures evolve.
Ali, actually, if I if you look at Iran, for example, based on what I've seen in Iran, you will think, well, this is the Iranian culture. But even if you look at there, the people that take Islam seriously within that country, you can see the authority of the woman within the family is much lower than people that don't take Islam very seriously, right? So if this was a local thing and not a religious thing, then within Iran, with people that don't practice Islam or do practice Islam, it should have been the same level of authority of women. But you could see that women's education and their voice and what they say matters a lot more in families that don't take. And actually, one story that I always remember is when I was in a private institution that was preparing us for the university entrance exam in Tehran, when we were on studying Islam and we were in a chapter on women's right, when we were going through the verses of the Quran and some hadiths and tried to show why they're not anti-women, and this was a private institution, so both boys and girls were in the class, one of the girls just started crying. And she was just reading the verses that were in front of her, and the explanation was supposed to show that they are not anti-women, but she was just reading them, and it was pretty obvious. I mean, the fact that you have to have a chapter to explain why these are not anti-women says a lot about how anti-women these verses and these hadiths were, right? And she just read them, and she just started crying. So, and the teacher went to her, and she's like, "It's okay, this happens a lot," and This is a girl that was in Iran. This is the first time that she was reading these verses and these hadiths. This is not a girl that was being manipulated by the Western media. So this, you know, she just has never read these before. And this is, so it can't be brainwashing by people that are anti-Islamic. These were just simple verses right in front of her. And she just read them for the first time, and she realized how anti-woman these ideas were. So, you know, I do think, you know, within each country, if you see that how religion within a country can influence how anti-woman a family is, it's not just West versus East, you know, and if it was culture, it wouldn't be that different.
And just right. to continue from what you were saying there, Armin, as a Muslim girl, to be told that the person that we admire the best example of humanity, the person that we all want to emulate, is somebody who married a 6-year-old girl and basically raped her by the time she was 9. For any girl to hear that, I cannot tell you how terrifying that is. So you have to overcome that terror that you feel, and you have to be like, I have to love this man. I have to love this man that would do this. And if I don't, I'm going to burn in hell. Like, when we talk about Islam, I think Sarah Hayter was saying it's a gendered religion. It's made, we all know all religions are made for men, by men. But the way that it oppresses women is so much more sinister than the way that it oppresses men.
Yeah, no, that's true. I completely agree. I mean, this is, I can just sort of tell when, you know, Alishba's my wife, and she's also a secular activist. I can just tell from the threats, whenever we get threats, I always get this, like, you know, you come to Pakistan and we'll kill you, we'll do this, we'll do that. With her, it's, you know, I'm going to put this gun in your vagina and I'm going to shoot. And I'm going to do, like, everything is sexualized. It's so, you know, and this is coming from religious people. It's coming from pious
that's just
people
women
who are offended.
And, like, we have to deal with that kind of shit anyway, regardless of religion.
Mm-hmm. But Shazia, speaking of threats, how often do you get them? What do you do with them? Like, what's with the level of threat to your work?
I am quite fortunate. I don't. And anything on social media, I've just learned the hard way not to feed the trolls. So I mute everybody or block. I don't engage with anybody. So if there are threats out there, I'm quite fortunate that I don't see them.
In your work, you're not in the front lines, right? You're training the people that are on the front lines.
Yeah, I'm not in the Pakistani community. I'm not welcome in the Pakistani community, so I wouldn't go in there and and speak to the women or anything like that. Spoken to some women on the phone. I don't mind giving support over the phone to women, but to actually go out into the community and know that I wouldn't feel safe doing that.
Do they still know who you are?
Yeah.
You're the troublemaker.
Yeah, I'm the rebel.
Good for you.
The black sheep of the family.
That's why I love you. I'm also the black sheep. Yeah. Black sheep are the best.
Are black sheep racist? Is it racist to say black sheep? You know, talking about all that, I remember, God,
how, Baba black sheep.
You're not allowed to say Baba black sheep. You're not allowed to sing Baba black
sheep of color.
And you know what? This is what I used to always find really, really strange. So you're not allowed to call it a blackboard anymore, but we were to call it a whiteboard. So was it not racist to the white people?
White people don't matter.
White people just need to suck it up.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, over here we have whiteboards now. I rarely ever see blackboards again. And that's another, it's a sign. I mean, that's why Trump's president now.
Political correctness gone mad.
Reason 5,042 why Trump is the president.
Whiteboards.
Yeah, the whiteboards.
It's all traced back to the whiteboards.
Can I just bring something in? Going back to like the Quran. So like I read the Quran when I was little, and I used to read namaz, but I don't speak Arabic. So I didn't know what I was reading. And you were talking about, you know, about Muhammad and marrying Aisha and raping her. I was in my 30s before I heard that story. So we weren't raised, our family personally, it's not to say that all Pakistani families are the same, but we weren't told anything about Islam. We just had to read the Quran, read the namaz, that was it. We weren't told stories about Islam and stuff like that. So I found out all these things, obviously, through social media, and once the internet was up and running and started Googling things and learning for myself. So a lot of these, you know, people that threaten you, and they don't have a clue what they're reading or what even Islam is. You know, there's a lot of ignorance,
so sad,
because we don't speak Arabic and we don't read it in English. We have to read it in Arabic only.
I feel like if a lot of these people did understand what they were reading, they would run.
Especially women.
Run from that religion.
You know, hell's full of women.
Yep.
I want to go to hell.
Because
right
women
now.
Are less intelligent. What was that, Faisal?
She said the hell is full of women. I said, I want to go to hell right now.
That's like, right.
I used to, people used to ask me about that. They're like, what if you find out that it's, that you were wrong and, you know, that there is a God and there is a heaven and hell? What would you do? And I tell them, aren't you scared of that? And I always told them, I'm like, no, I'm very confident that if that's true, I'm going straight to heaven. And they'd be like, what? And I'm like, yeah, I think that if there is a God that created the universe and time dilation and binary pulsars and all of that, I don't think he really cares if I eat pork or not. And I know that all these things exist. I know that anybody who is that smart or that brilliant to create all of these things is not going to send me to hell because I questioned using the same intellectual faculties that, you know, he apparently provided me with. So I would, yeah, if there is a, when they ask me about the Pascal's wager, about, you know, whether you're wrong, I was telling them, like, I'm pretty much 100% sure that if there turns out to be a God, and I'll just tell them, I'm like, hey, I questioned you. You're here. Now I believe you. They're like, all right, go to heaven.
I just can't get my head around that somebody would create us to then have us burn in hell for eternity and give you fresh skin and fresh nerve endings every time those ones had been burnt out. I could just never understand. Like, somebody created you. You know, would you do that to your own child? No, so...
It's sort of like, you know, you believe in Santa Claus as a kid and then nobody tells you that he's not real and you just continue.
Santa's nice, though. He brings you presents. He doesn't burn you for eternity.
Santa doesn't bring Muslim children presents.
No, but he can put coal in your socks. He can put coal in your socks and that contributes
so
to global warming. Like, that's not good. That's why we have climate change.
The war on coal.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, Santa's a bit of an asshole in his own way.
God is just like a glamorized, more intense version of Santa
Claus. By the way, you know, when you guys mentioned there's more women in hell, that's actually a hadith by Muhammad, isn't it? The fact
that is.
Yes, it is. And it's because they're less intelligent. Yeah,
he basically did mention that if you go to hell, you're gonna notice that most of its occupants are women. So that's not very nice.
Okay. Then he was asked, why were most of the occupants going to be women? And he said, the answer was, because you guys are less intelligent. And that's proven by the fact that we need two women to testify for one man in a court of law. Mm-hmm. And because you guys are deficient in religion, because you can't pray when you have your period, which always got me. I'm like, that God is a real asshole, because that's quite the gotcha, right? Like, he's the one that makes us like, we don't want to menstruate. Like, that's fine. You can take that back. He makes us do it.
And then punishes us.
And then he says, now you can't pray. And then he says, ha, and I'm going to put you in hell because now you can't pray because I made you have your period. Fuck you.
And you know what? I don't think you would ever hear any man say that I am jealous of the woman who with her period, except for a closeted ex-Muslim who's like, my sister doesn't have to pray 5 days and I do. So, we actually had period envy.
But the thing is, like, this is actually bad marketing, if you think about it. I mean, if he says that the hell, if he says that hell is going to be filled with women, isn't that it's just like they remember
Faisal, you're forgetting the Huris, because you don't want human women, because human women are not obedient. You want angel women. Angel women have no free will, and they just do whatever you want. So
they're basically sex dolls.
Sex slaves.
Yeah, but like, I mean, that kind of reminds me, like, you remember during the election when there was this guy who was a Mexican said, if you vote for Hillary, there's going to be a taco cart at every corner. Like, this is actually...
That's not a bad thing.
This is actually...
I don't know why they do that.
Like, if there's going to be a taco cart, that taco cart in every corner, I would vote for Hillary just for that.
Totally.
If hell is going to be filled with women, I would want to go to hell just for that. Like,
sign me up.
Like, sign me up.
The fact that angels have no free will, that makes it slavery, right? So we should like start an organization for the rights of angels against God, like a union or something.
Well, you know what? I'm going to quote House here, Armin. You're a very rational person, and if you could reason with religious people, there would be no religious people. That's what House said.
But
we should let our guest talk, because we have been talking quite much.
What's this list of stuff you have here, Faisal?
I a lot of people, when they mention that Islam is against women, they mention that verse that Ali mentioned that allows you, actually teaches you that you're supposed to beat your woman if they don't listen to you after you exhausted three other options. But there's a whole bunch of other things, like even some of the, when we were being taught in Iran that Islam is pro-woman, the verse that they mentioned was, I forgot what the exact verse was, but it was mentioning that women are from God to you men. Mm. And that was supposed to be the pro-woman verse. And I was like, okay, so it's treated them like a property.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but I've noticed that many Muslims are using kind of Western terminology to be able to compete with the West. So just like the Democratic Republic of North Korea is like use the term, say, like North Korea say we are a democratic republic, or China say we are the People's Republic of China.
Mm-hmm.
Even though the Democratic Republic of North Korea is neither democratic or, but I'm noticing that now the Muslim communities or community leadership, like Linda Sarsour and people like her, are trying to use Western terminology, like Islam is pro-feminism. Muhammad was the first. So they're kind of using, Western liberal terminology to say that, you know what, you get it all along. Like, it's just always the case with religious people, like, oh, evolution versus false. Then it was mentioned in the Quran. Like, okay, so you just said it false. Now it's mentioned in the Quran. Like, okay, like, it's just like, It's always the first step. It's false. It's against God. And then it's like, oh, don't you know that the Big Bang is mentioned in the Quran? Well, then why the fuck then the scientists work all the freaking hours?
They wasted so much time.
Well, you know, last year when they discovered the gravitational waves, it was a big, you know, the cosmic wave background's a big physics discovery, and they discovered gravitational waves. There was already an article out by... Yeah, there was already an article out that said that talked about how they were mentioned in the Quran and they were predicted by the Quran.
It's funny though. It's actually funny. It's like screw all the scientist forkers. Like it's also already mentioned in the Quran. Like why the hell?
But going back to what I was trying to say is like I just want to point out to whoever hasn't read the Quran or the Hadith, there's a whole bunch of anti-woman teachings. Like it's not just that one verse, right? Like the testimony of a woman is like half of a man. A woman that you capture in war and that you could the woman that you capture as slave and war against the enemies of Allah, you could have them as sex slaves. That's actually in the Quran. In the Quran, this is not even Hadith. There's so many other inheritance
of a exactly. woman.
And these
is half of a man.
And these are actually used in law. Actually, in Iran, for example,
this is Sharia.
And you know, even the four, you know, the one that is you need four witnesses, right? That has been four witnesses to prove that an adultery has been taking place. That has been really bad for women in Pakistan, right? So imagine if you're in Pakistan or even in Dubai, which is a lot of people consider it much more liberal or westernized, right? A lot of women, when they go and report rape, right? This is because of this Quranic verse. Again, this is not Hadith. This is in the Quran, direct words of God. If these women that are reporting rape cannot find four witnesses, imagine how hard it is to find four witnesses for somebody raping you. That means
four male witnesses.
Yeah.
That means not only your accusation does not stand that you know that somebody has raped you, you actually have now admitted to adultery and you are the one that is going to get arrested. So you were just a victim of rape and now you have admitted to the authorities that you have committed adultery and you get arrested.
And I just want to add to that I remember when I was a kid and I heard that and I asked my mom like, okay, what if there was like a security camera? And she's like, nope, because it doesn't say in the Quran that it's going to be a security camera. It has to be four men. And I recently in Pakistan, they were like, okay, what about DNA evidence? If we have DNA evidence, does that work? And they said, nope, because the Quran doesn't say DNA evidence. So it goes back to Ali's point of like culture can progress, but religion cannot progress. So having these strict parameters, nobody ever in the past 1400 years has ever raped anybody then. Mm-hmm.
In the Quran, rape doesn't exist. There's no such thing as rape in the Quran. There's no, the word zina, which is used, is it just means illegal sex.
Adultery.
And illegal sex is fornication or adultery. Those are the only two things.
Right.
So what it talks about.
But if you need four male witnesses to that, that's never going to happen.
Well, that's the four male witnesses are, they're for fornication or adultery. But the idea of consent of rape is never mentioned in the Quran. Mm-hmm. And people, what they do is they take zina to mean rape as well. And
there's no such thing. You can rape your wife. It's no problem. You can rape whoever you want as long as she's doesn't belong to a man.
I have a question. To be the devil's advocate. So, I mean, I've been watching quite of these shows, and one of the things that struck me is that have you guys seen this Australian debate about this woman who was telling about the Sharia law, and the woman said, "You don't know what the hell Sharia law is. Sharia is about kind of like the guideline people follow to reach God." And then, like Armin mentioned, Sharia law as being against women. What do you guys think about this definition that Sharia actually means what someone follows to achieve?
No, because Sharia also teaches you enforcement methods. If it was only a guide for you to you could follow if you wanted, if you don't want to follow it, then what are the detailed, very, very detailed enforcement methods of what you do with the people that don't follow these rules? Then what's the point of adding that if it's just like, because these I think if I'm understanding you right, these people are suggesting that this is not something a government is supposed to enforce. This is just something that, you know, just a guide to life. But then what's the point of, you know, stoning people if they don't listen to it? Like, how, that's in the hadith, right? So that's also in the Sharia law. Do you know? That basically contradicts what they're saying.
I mean, tied to that definition, I mean, do you think, Shazia, that question is for you. Do you think that this kind of obfuscation of the definitions of Sharia is harmful to the women and children that are being raised in the UK within Muslim communities?
Yeah.
Do you feel like the work that you're doing is...
We have Sharia courts in the UK. There's a figure of 85, which will never be the right number. So we have Sharia courts in the UK.
Because Maryam Namazi's working against those.
There's an inquiry at the moment as well to try and get them shut down. And I read something on Twitter today that I didn't know either, that women going to the Sharia courts in the UK are charged hundreds of pounds to divorce their husbands or whatever service it is they're going to use the Sharia courts for. But men don't get charged, but women do.
That's like, that reminds me of when I was in Qatar, which is a Sharia law country, obviously, and I had a student who wouldn't come to class, and I brought her into my office and I was like, sit down, Amina. I need to talk to you. Like, you know, what's going on with you? It feels like you don't even want to be in school. You don't even really want to be here. And she's like, yeah, I don't. I was like, what? And then she said that she had basically a man, her parents had forced her to marry some guy. It was her cousin, obviously her first cousin. She was married to him and he hit her. So she went back to her parents and she said, he hit me. And her parents were like, so what? That's his right. You're his wife. And as Ali mentioned, as Quran 434, and then her dad said, you have to go back to your husband because you're embarrassing me. But her mom said, it's okay, you can live downstairs with the maids. In Qatar, they're extremely wealthy and they have like maids' quarters. So the mom said, you go downstairs and live with the maids in the basement. And so she did, and she already had her husband's permission to go to school, but she didn't have permission to do anything else. So that was the only thing she could do, was go to school. Meanwhile, he remarried because he can have up to four wives. He remarried and has new kids and he's leaving her to rot because he knows this can be a good punishment for her. And I, in my dumb Canadian naivete, because I had just read that women in Qatar can now get divorces, I said, why don't you just go to the court and get a divorce? Because that's what you would ask normally. And she was like, basically, like, seriously, do you think that there's any judge in this world or in this country that's going to allow me a divorce with my last name, with my father being who he is and my husband being who he is? I'll never be able to get a divorce. So when, and in Islam, a man could divorce his wife by saying talaq three times, which is just basically saying divorce. You're divorced. You're divorced. You're divorced. That's all he has to just say it because his magical words.
You just divorced all of us, by the way. By saying this.
I don't have the power because I don't have a penis. So then she's divorced. But she can't do the same thing. She can't. There's nothing she can do to get out of this divorce. So that continues through in the Sharia law countries, and it continues through in the UK as well, where it's just more restrictive for women to get a divorce than it is for men.
I thought I could divorce my husband that way. I didn't realise it was only
that's cute.
It was only men that could do it. And I did 6 months after I was married. I said it to him and he just looked as an idiot. But yeah,
it should. Why not though, right? Because like, why women, not? If he can say it to you, why can't you say it to him?
Because it's man-made religion for men.
That's sexist.
Yeah,
it's deal with definitely it. Sexist.
Another thing people say is that this was like the fact that this is so male-oriented is nothing bad about Islam because this was so common at the time. Like, it was expected, right? It's expected for any kind of ideology or culture from that era to be anti-woman and pro-men. So
except the Quran is for all people for all time.
Exactly. The point is, and so people say we shouldn't criticize Islam given when it's coming from. I'm like, yeah, well, so you basically, these people are making our point. Our point is that these ideologies don't belong in our time anymore, right? So mm-hmm. fine, is compared to ideologies at that time, it wasn't any worse, maybe, or maybe it was even better. That doesn't make it fine for today, right? Because we are living with these ideologies today. The standard saying that it was better than ideologies at the time is not a very high bar for you to achieve. That's not much to say. But another thing is that I just want people to understand that if they don't really think that this has an Islamic source, just go read the Quran cover to cover. You get the understanding that even the verses that are not about women, it's clear that it's talking to men. All right, this book was not written with the idea that women would be reading it. This book is written for, like, because women are just, you know, following whatever the husband does. It are just possessions, and it talks about them as if they're possession. But the audience of the Quran is the men in the household. And another thing about what Faisal said when he said that the Sharia, you know, these people that try to reduce how influential Sharia is and how harmful it could be in a society or in a family. A lot of people that do take Islam, Muslims that do take Islam seriously, it's not just us that's saying that these people don't understand Islam. Most Muslims also will point out that these people that are saying Sharia is not something that you endorse, most Muslims know that that's ridiculous to say, right? So this is not something that we are saying against Islam. This is something that most Muslims, most scholars also say about Islam. And not just recent scholars throughout time, scholars that, you know, these modern interpretations of Islam in the West, a lot of people say, like, well, you guys don't, you know, haven't studied it. You guys don't understand Arabic. This is not your language. How could you understand this? Well, go look at the scholars that lived at that time that their first language was Arabic. Look at the tafsir. Look at how they interpreted the Quran. Look at how they viewed women, right? These are the people with the best understanding because they were closest to Muhammad and they spoke the language. They not only spoke Arabic, they spoke the same Arabic, that the traditional Arabic that Muhammad spoke. And go look at their interpretations of the Quran. And if they're getting these interpretations wrong, how bad was the Quran written for it to be interpreted this way time and time and again and consistently against women? So if the Quran is not anti-women, it was really poorly written. And any God that wrote it should have understood that most people would read it and understand that you are allowed to beat your wife, according to Quran. Even if he didn't mean it, he should have known that this verse will be interpreted this way. And if he had any intention of making sure men and women were equal, it was actually very easy for him to make it clear that that's the case. And he didn't. And he used metaphor and weird language to make it very unclear that actually men are superior.
Yeah, that's not unclear though. Like there's a lot of verses, I think, that people like to say, oh, it's subjective and it's hard to understand and blah, blah, blah. Dogma is still a word that we use today. Like there are some words that we lose over time, of course, and there's some words that we still use. That phrase of hitting your wife is not in any way, shape, or form subjective. It's very clear.
Adribuhunna.
And yes, that's right. And then also the one about the men being qawmun ala nisa, that's they're the guardians of women, are responsible for women like she's their fucking pet puppy or something. That's also very clear. So it's kind of back to your point, Armin, before when you were talking about, like, if you're in the Harry Potter world and you've got like these little disagreements within the Harry Potter world, but then people like to bring in Star Wars or Star Trek and they bring it in and they say, okay, that's how I feel when people start to say, oh, I don't know if it really means hitting your wife. You know, maybe it just means bringing her flowers and chocolate. I'm like, it's perfectly clear.
That's actually really a non-Arabic, you know, people, most of the people I know who speak Arabic, they have no doubt that adrubuhunna means beat your wife. They know that.
Yeah.
The so striking we still a separation. Use that word. If it said adrubuhunna, that would mean strike a separation, but it doesn't say that. It says adrubuhunna. So the people who try to interpret it differently and they say it means something else are usually South Full Asians, they're Indians, Pakistanis, sometimes Iranians, sorry, Armin. Just people who are non-Arabic speaking, they tend to have all
or
of
apologists.
These. Yeah, they're like, this word actually means this, and that's a big problem. When you know what I was saying earlier, like this whole idea of rape, it's very easy for a God to say, okay, one of the biggest crimes perpetuated in history against half of humanity, you can just say, don't rape. But it's not in the Quran. It's not in there. That rape as an entity doesn't even exist. I mean, even in the Ten Commandments, it tells you not to talk to your parents. Well, it says, don't take the Lord of the name, the name of the Lord in vain, but just doesn't say don't rape.
I mean, the guy can create all these planets and the earth and the sun and the stars and the moon and the plants and the animals, and he can't write a fucking book properly without such ambiguity.
Can't write a book. And you know, the funny thing is, like, the other main claim to fame with the Quran is the embryology claims. You guys have probably heard this, that, you know, the Quran predicted embryology.
Of course it did.
That if anybody wants that debunked, go read my book. You know, I wish I didn't have to do a shameless plug, but I kind of went and I wrote that in detail in my book about how those claims of embryology, all you had to do was crack open a fertilized chicken egg and you would have seen every stage, and it fits completely with everything the Quran says about embryology. That aside, the one thing that the Quran does not mention when you're talking about embryology is the ovum. The egg is never mentioned in the Quran. There's this idea of like male and female sperm and things like that. It's obviously all wrong, but it's just not mentioned in there. And you cannot have any claim or any credibility when you're talking about embryology if you don't mention the ovum. So you know,
or the thing that the sperm is created on the back of the guy. Do you know this?
Everybody should look this up. It's I think Surah 86, verses 5
because
to 7.
Science hasn't caught up yet.
It says that God created man from a fluid ejected between the backbone and the ribs. So I asked this guy, Kashif Chaudhry, about whenever Fessel hears his name, he laughs for some reason. It's a funny name. I don't know why. But anyway, so I asked him about it.
The name is funny.
And he's like, well, because it is between the bone and the ribs and the chest. And he sent me a picture of he wrote a blog post on this. It's called, you know, does the Quran say sperm is made in the chest? That is the name of the fucking title. I'm not even kidding. Anyway, then it has this huge picture of this woman who is pregnant and he has a baby in there. And it says, look, you know, something like the genitals of the baby form between the ribs and the backbone of the woman. I'm like, dude, this is not about the verse is about a man. It's not about a pregnant woman. It's not what it is. And they just go crazy trying to justify it. They're like, well, that is kind of where the area is. I'm like, that's like saying that, yeah, Chicago is somewhere in the Western Hemisphere. You know, it's true, but you know, that's not really geographical expertise. You know, this is a really fun topic for me just because there's so much humor in it. It's just so funny.
But then a lot of people mention that the Quran is not supposed to be a scientific book. Well, then why is it talking about these things? Is it if it's trying to impress us, it could have just put something it was so obviously accurate, like we will find out later, and it would have been a miracle. And if it's not trying to give us a miracle, then why is it trying? Like, why is it obviously trying to give us scientific information when we find it is wrong?
You just don't understand, Armin. That's why.
And I want to quote Armin because Armin types these things and he doesn't say them, and they're really profound. He said in the chat window, he's like, the Quran could simply have one verse. Nothing can be faster than light. That would be a miracle. And honestly, that's it. It just needs one thing that is true that people didn't know back then that we know now. And that would have been it. Like, that really would have been convincing, but that's not the case.
right? And
yeah, speaking of cases, I want to bring this back to the conversation.
What is this segue going to be?
He just wants
speaking
to
of cases.
Case of beer.
Yeah, so that's actually funny. So yeah, well, like talking about interpretations, and Shazia mentioned Majid Nawaz, who is on the Good Guys, according to her. That's probably definitely the same.
He is the good guy.
Yeah, definitely my side as well. Reform movement, and that's something that's going on, the conversation about it quite frequently. What do you think
Faisal
about
asks
it?
All our guests, Shazia, I should have warned
you. Yeah, that's fine. Yep. What do you think
of the reform movement, and how do you think it's going to be effective, and how and will it help in the cases and the communities that you're trying to serve?
I think that, you know, the Quran is the final word, so it can't be changed. Muhammad is the final. There's no messenger coming after Muhammad. We're not going to have another.
Armin smiling.
Another prophet, or so it's going to be really difficult to change, because you're going to have, you know, the fundi Muslims and just moderate and just Muslims, just normal Muslims who believe in the that it's the final word of God. So you can't change that. You can't. But I think having the conversation is good.
I think that's a very good point. You're basically saying why. Yeah, why is this need for all this interpretation? That's supposed to be the final word. Like, why is it not good enough, right?
Yeah. It's the final word, and we're having all these discussions about can we change it? And I had spoke to somebody today about, you know, maybe reform is not possible, but changing the mindset of Muslims. And I think
that's Ali's stance.
That's right. And I've always had, you know, reform always kind of sounded to me like, and it does, I guess it could work in some sort of practical sense for some people, is that someone's just saying, hey, put down your Quran and listen to me. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, forget about the words of God as he wrote them. About God's words, but listen to my commentary on what God said. And it's a listen to my human words. So what you have now is you have three books talking and were written about two verses. And, you know, you're there's this like meme out there that shows the picture of the Quran. And then it shows a picture of a much, much bigger, thicker book that says how to interpret the Quran.
Yeah.
You know, and then obviously the one about how to interpret is written by men. And ultimately what happens is all these professors and stuff who do the interpretation, ISIS and the people that are actually causing all the problems in the world, they're not quoting those professors. They're not quoting even Majid Nawaz, actually, unfortunately. They're quoting the Quran and they're quoting the Hadith. So there is a problem there. And I actually, you know, we had a whole episode on this last time, went on for a very long time. And we don't really know exactly what the solution to this is.
We don't know the final solution.
And actually, this makes it even, your point is actually, makes it even worse when the Quran itself says that the Quran is in clear language, is for everybody, right? So it makes it easier for people that are taking it literally, like, why are these scholars and all these reformers trying to make it more complicated? The Quran itself says, just read the freaking book. It's in black and white. Why are you trying to change this?
It's a first revelation. Iqra.
It's pretty unclear. It's unedited version. It's his first draft.
You know, a lot of scholars that a lot of people that say, like, why are you interpreting the Quran? You're not a scholar. You haven't studied Islam. Apparently you haven't read it either, because the book itself says it's in clear language. It's a book that was supposed to be understood by everybody, by the scholar and the shepherd, and anybody with no education should have been able to pick it up and read it and understand exactly what God wants. And that's what the Quran itself promises itself to be.
It's written by an illiterate guy, so that's why it's probably needs some work.
Well, according to Reza Aslan, he was actually unlettered.
There's just too many scholars, too many sheikhs, too many mullahs, too many community leaders, and just too many different points of view. Nobody's ever going to agree and say, this is what the Quran is. This is the way we should do it.
Yeah, that probably is to some extent a little bit of a blessing, because you know, it's the fact that, you know, people can actually look at it and like, oh, this doesn't mean this, this doesn't mean that, and pretty much, you know, when nothing means anything, then the whole thing is useless, right? So it just ends up being that way.
You know, and even Salafis play with that, because, you know, mm-hmm. Salafis are supposed to be hardcore and they follow the everything to the verse, but when it comes to bid'ah, mm-hmm. they totally play with it. Like, I remember saying to my mom, so we shouldn't be riding in cars then, because Prophet Muhammad didn't have a car, so that's an invention after yeah. him. And she's like, yeah. well, no, because they rode camels and that's transportation, and so this is just transportation. So, you know, it is when they want it to work, it works. Make it up, yeah.
Yeah, there's nothing rational about it. I mean, that's the whole thing. I mean, you're talking about angels and jinns and
yeah.
you know, flying horses and all that. I mean, when you're supposed to take that on just on faith, you know, you're not gonna listen. Like, the logic thing doesn't matter. You can justify anything to yourself. So,
did I ever tell you guys that my uncle is a jinn hunter?
What?
How come he hasn't found a ton of cash?
How come he hasn't found me yet?
Wait, can you explain to me, jinn is like demon for Islam, right?
A jinn is not necessarily a demon, because they're not necessarily bad. Yeah, they can be. They're just sort of like these invisible beings that live amongst us.
And are made of fire.
And sometimes they if a girl gets pregnant, for example, and she hasn't had sex with anybody, it might have been a jinn.
Yeah, but this
stuff like that. They come in handy.
This is different than the jinn.
Yeah, that's one thing we want people to believe. That part is
the word jinn comes from, by the way. Yeah,
that's right.
And by the way, so there's three conscious entities in Islam, right? There's angels that are made out of light, jinns, which are made out of fire, and humans, which are made out of mud or dust, right?
Clay.
Oh my God! Just hearing that again is just—it's so
from these three entities. But from these three entities, only two.
They're made out of light and fire and clay.
Yeah, but angels are made of
chickpeas.
Guys, let me just.
Hummus was the chief angel. Anyway, go ahead. That's why they named it Hummus.
And the devil, unlike Christianity, he wasn't an angel. He was a jinn, right? So, and the reason why he didn't bow down to Adam was because he said fire is above mud. Right,
Armin, you're so cute. You're like a teacher trying to keep track of these unruly children in your classroom.
Right. He's
like, I'm trying to teach
he's
you.
He's right. This is exactly.
Okay, sorry. Go on.
This is for the audience. Like, I just really want the audience to know everything Armin is saying. This is what we grew up with. It's. I mean, it's just as stupid as all the stuff that. I mean, people who are Christians will relate
cool
to this.
They also have angels
and virgin births.
It's actually,
but
yeah, it's fun if you don't believe.
It's
in
a lot of fun. Yeah, it's fucking
I'm
awesome.
I'm terrified of the jinns.
Yeah, me too.
And jinns, on average, are more. Not actually. Some jinns converted to Islam when Muhammad was teaching, and he was like, yeah,
sure.
but when Hussein was fighting Yazid, there were thousands of angels in his army. That's how he survived for so long, right? People couldn't see, like, heads were being cut off, like people couldn't see, like there were invisible swords and jinns were flying anywhere. But anyways, from these three entities, only two of them have free will. Angels don't have free will. Humans and jinns do. Jinns on an average are worse than humans, but there are some good jinns, especially the ones that first converted to Islam when Muhammad was reading the Quran.
I mean, if you mix gin with coke, it's actually
good. You know, gins. But you know, it's just so funny that when I was listening to this thing about, I think it was the Reza Aslan show on CNN. He was talking about Scientology and these people who had this, you know, that e-meter that they have that they hook you up to, and they audit you and your deeds or whatever, and then they check to see if you're lying and by measuring the stress in you. And people make fun of that. Yeah, you know, like all these Scientologists, they believe in the Xenu, that, you know, all this weird like all their mythology. People mock it all the time. And I just think, I'm like, that e-meter, at least it's got, it's actually makes a little bit more sense than these like djinns made out of fire and this made out of light. And then, you know, the talking snake and the Garden of Eden and that the staff, like remember Moses threw the, his stick down and it turned into a snake. Just like these things are so stupid. I mean, they're just, there's grown educated. And this is the problem. This is how, you know, people say, why did Trump win? People say, you know, why is Trump winning? Why are people believing? They're believing all the fake news. They're believing all of these lies in the media. I'm like, well, if you have 80% of the population, including the vice president, going around talking about how, you know, angels and that Earth's 6,000 years old and, you know, the staff's turning into snakes, why would it be so hard to, for him to fall for the lies of a politician, as mythical as they are, you know? So, and this goes to Armin's point about the reform that he last made. That, you know, if you come around with that, what was it, that pixie dust or whatever it is that you treat people with, and you say I have the cure, and you're lying to them, you know, that reform just gives them a version of bullshit. And if you do that, you're not asking them to seek the truth. You're giving them a solution that works temporarily, but you're not giving them the process to actually get to the truth later on. And this is one of the biggest problems with religion. It's not just the fact that people believe in it and do dumb things. It's just that it screws up the process by which they believe things. They believe things based on faith. They believe that there was a flying horse or a virgin gave birth. And once you believe that, Donald Trump or any other politician can come out, or Hitler, they can come out, they can fucking make you believe anything, right? Because your bar is already lowered. And that is a real toxicity of religion and faith in general. And faith goes, that it goes beyond Islam, beyond all the other stuff. It's just that is really, really the root cause, believing things without evidence.
I mean, speaking of believing things without evidence, do you guys remember the stories of that you have two angels on your shoulder?
Yeah.
Yes. One is Sunni and one is Shia. And then you go.
Was it an angel on your right shoulder and a devil on your left? And they're writing down the good things that you do, or writing down the bad things that you do. Yeah.
And then you go to Yom Al Qiyamah, and they're like, it's like a hard drive, right? So it's going to record all the things that you have. And it never goes formatted. You cannot format that hard drive. If you walk to Imam Hussein, you can format all the shit you want. But then you're gonna go to Allah, and then the angel is gonna come out of your shoulder and tells you like, what the fuck? You were masturbating in Karbala in 1991.
That even to this day, that freaks me out. I hear it. I'm like, masturbating in Karbala. How could he ever say that? Like that, I still have that.
Just once that year.
Masturbating in Karbala in 1991. You're gonna go to hell because the angel never forgets. So in one way. In one way, like, you could always be accountable for your actions, but it's just like, it's
fuckers.
But your hands will be pregnant anyway, won't they?
What were you saying, Shazia?
Yeah. I'm saying your hands will be pregnant when you judgment day.
So the people that, men that masturbate, when they go to Qiyamah or the judgment day, they'll find their hands are pregnant.
Yeah, they do. They find their hands. With
small little hands, or
their hands get pregnant.
little baby in their hand.
Little baby hands.
They're gonna be mushrooms.
That's just disgusting.
Oh,
speaking of disgusting,
psychotic.
Speaking of disgusting. Sorry. No.
These are teachings of Islam, people. We're not making this stuff up. This is Islamic teaching.
Yeah, be grateful that you were born and raised in this shit.
And they're familiar. I mean, this is one part. Yeah, Islam is like uniquely dangerous when it comes to terrorism. So I'm not saying that, but this really is. This kind of stuff goes across all religions. Stuff. Like the bullshit aspect, and just the fact that grown adults believing stupid things. I mean, this is something that is universal when it comes to religion, unfortunately.
So Shazia, these women that are leaving their families because of abuse or forced marriages or all of these different reasons, are they, most of them, are they still Muslim, or are they questioning their faith?
Still Muslim.
So they're not at the point where they're going to see that the cause, root evil for what's happened to them is from Islam. They're not there.
They're still very much Muslim.
Why do you think that?
What about for you? When did you, because you went through, I know you went through a lot, because you, there was no support system for you.
I was always Muslim. I was always just not a very good Muslim. I didn't eat pork for the longest time, because then that would be the final never going back. And I think it's just the biggest, you know.
Like, what was it that made you change your mind? Like, I know all the abuse and everything made you get away from your family, but what made you go away from religion?
Same, the internet, discovering other people, just finding out that I could. I didn't know that I could, you know, that's why I said I was always, people always ask what your religion is. I have a Muslim name, so you're always asked. And I'd always say I was Muslim, just not practicing. And then started, who's the crazy one? What's his name? You know, the Indian scholar. He's banned from the UK.
The one that just went to prison?
No, Zakir Naik?
Yes.
Oh, is he banned from the UK?
Yeah.
He was banned from the UK. So I had friends that thought he was God.
He's so funny, that
so
guy.
So I Googled him. Such a fucking moron. I remember listening to him talking and thinking, you're crazy, but I can't say anything to these people because these people think he is God. They think, you know, he's just amazing. And then just as you Google, other stuff starts coming up and you start looking at the other side of Islam as well, and, you know, ex-Muslims, and just from there, just discovering other ex-Muslims and realizing that, you know, you actually can question, because we were never allowed to question. We were never allowed to question Islam. We were told, and, you know, that was
you mentioned it, so. Eating pork was for the final step. That's very interesting, because for a lot of Muslims, pork is way, way worse than alcohol. You eventually did try pork. Was that like a very, what was that experience like?
Amazing.
What kind
was
of pork
bacon?
Did you try?
What was the first
bacon.
Thing you tried?
Just bacon. Yeah. I won't eat any other. I'm vegetarian anyway.
Well,
now,
they had that scene in East is East, right? In East is East, when they were like making bacon, and then their dad came home and they started like, you know, fanning everything and like, yeah, just getting rid of the smell.
Yeah, the smell is woeful. Yeah. Like, the smell of bacon is just, but the taste of bacon is heavenly.
It's heavenly. It is heaven. That
but
is
the guilt. I still have the guilt when I eat it. The guilt is still there.
It's like masturbating in Karbala. Having bacon. It's like, but so speaking of masturbating in Karbala, like, no, I'm kidding. I'm trying to do a festival segue, but I'm just not as good at it. But so I don't know. I was thinking, like, you know, we're up over 2 hours and we're still having a lot of fun. I guess we'd go for a very long time, but we should probably.
No, I want Shazia to end us on a positive note. Oh, a happy ending, as Faisal likes to call it.
Oh God, so tell us... happy ending. You did it. You made the segue. Good.
Happy so ending.
Are
good.
You feeling
good. $5?
He's a cheap whore.
Oh man,
Faisal's a cheap whore.
Yeah.
So can you give us a are there any positive stories you can share with us about the work that you've done or any things that you feel like, because I know that you've been through so much. And so to reach back, because I remember Faisal writing a Facebook post about this a long time ago, and it really opened my eyes and made me start to think differently. And he was talking about, now that we've overcome all of this stuff and we've come out and we're free and we're happy and we're in a completely different place, it's our responsibility to reach back and help the people that are in the positions that we were in. And I know that you do a lot of that in your work. So I was hoping we could end this chat on a positive story or note that you have to share with us about your what you're doing in your work.
It would have to be about the raising awareness, because I don't speak to a lot of the women that we help. And I think reason, just going to speaking at conferences. I spoke at a conference in February. It was down in England. It was a police headquarters. And I shared my life story with them. And I don't often share the sex abuse that happened, and sharing that and then getting messages. Because I always find when I share things, people always then reach out to you, whether it's through Twitter, whether it's through my website, sending messages and just giving hope to people. You know, I had a girl contact me that said that she hasn't got the courage to do anything about it yet, but listening to mine has given her a little bit of hope that she might reach out, and knowing that there's help out there for her, that people will believe her, because that's the biggest thing, that, you know, nobody believes us. It's not very positive, is it?
Well, it is, because now you believe her, right? And all the people that you train believe her. Like, these girls are going to have a completely different environment than you had when you left, right?
Yeah. And I think, you know, training people to, because the way I finished my talk with them was that if you don't help these girls because you're scared of being called a racist, then you're just as guilty mm-hmm. as those that are punishing the girls. You're just as guilty as those that are raping the girls in the community. You know, we talk about grooming gangs, and, you know, we talk about the 1,400 girls in Rotherham. Those men that groomed those girls will be raping girls in the community. They will be raping girls in their own homes, in the wider community. They're not just going to be raping white girls. You shut your eyes to that. You don't want to be called a bigot. You don't want to be called far right. You don't want to be called racist. And you're just as guilty of the people that force their children into marriages that allow all this to go on. So, yeah, I think...
Do you feel like you're getting through to them?
I think, you know, when I get messages from girls, Pakistani girls, it's always Pakistani girls, it makes me feel, it gives me hope that, you know, they, like you said, they've reached out to me. So reaching out to me can be the first step. And then actually going and getting professional help from, whether it's from the organisation that I work for, the Halo Project, or whether it's the police, whether it's other safeguarding agencies, social workers, teachers at school, anybody, just break the silence.
Do you feel like the liberals hear you though? Like when the people that are afraid of being called a bigot, when you tell them like you're condemning these girls to a life of misery and rape and abuse when you don't speak up for them, do they get it?
I hope so. I really, really do hope that they do get it. And, you know, the next girl that comes to them for help, you know, how many more Benazis are out there? Mm-hmm. How many more girls are going out there to police stations? You know, you watch that, you see the fear in her face when she's speaking to these police women and policemen, and they don't take it seriously mm-hmm. at all. So, yeah, I do hope that they take something on board, that they are listening. You know, they listen when I speak. I'm going to speak at a conference next month on domestic violence, and I'll probably end with the same. I'll always end with the same, that if you're scared of being called names, because that's all it is, it's just mm-hmm. names. You know, to allow this to happen because of culture, because of whatever, then you're just as guilty.
Well, we really appreciate the work that you're doing, Shazia, and we really appreciate you coming and talking to us today and telling us about your book. And for our listeners, again, the book is called The Gori's Daughter, and Gori is spelled G-O-R-I, by Shazia Hobbs, and it's available on Amazon. And I read it, and I read it with my book club, and Shazia was kind enough to come to our book club for a Skype meeting, and all seven of us were able to ask her questions and delve a little bit deeper. And it's a fantastic book. It's heartwarming and also heartbreaking. And I just can't believe how a girl from Egyptian family in Canada can have so much in common with a girl with Pakistani origins living in Scotland. Like, I'm glad you wrote the book.
You know, I read your writing, and reading your writing as well, I was like, oh my Allah. Like, you're my sister from another sister. It was just
how I felt.
So many similar things, and it's like we say, we're from completely different backgrounds. We should have nothing in common. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't have any similarities. But reading, you know, I messaged you and said that reading your writing just touched my heart. It was like Love you.
I love you. And I just wanted to mention to everybody, I found Shazia because of exMuslim, because that's how it happened. So in my book, at the beginning of every chapter, I chose an exMuslim because quote.
Yep.
And then I would tweet the person and let them know, like, okay, I chose your tweet to be the, you know, at the beginning of my chapter. And then that's how I chose your quote, because it was really poignant and it was perfect. And then I sent you a tweet and I let you know. And then it was just been, it's the rest is history. Like, I'm really, I'm really glad that we found each other. And that's thanks to Rehana Sultan and the team at the Councils of ex-Muslims of Britain for doing the hashtag ex-Muslims because, and connecting us. And, you know, I could have saved so much in therapy bills had social media been available 15 years ago.
Yeah.
Because it's just made such a big difference in my life. And
speaking of Twitter, and how can people follow you, Shazia? Like, what's your Twitter handle? How can people stay with, keeping up with your work?
It's Hobbs Shazia.
Yep, at Hobbs Shazia.
At Hobbs Shazia. I speak to so many. Do you know, I speak to, thanks to Twitter, I'm in contact with really young ex-Muslim.
Great.
Really young ones, like early 20s, mid-20s. And I do almost like a counselling service through DM with them, just reaching out to them. And a lot of them are still at home, obviously, so they're not openly ex-Muslim. And you just think...
It means the world, though, doesn't it? Like, imagine if you'd have had somebody to be able to send a message to in all those years when you were going from shelter to shelter and everything.
And feeling so isolated and thinking you were the only one that thought like this. So, social media and hashtags really do work.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. I actually want to add a bit to this before we end our talk is it's really amazing how this power of social media in helping out people and connecting people, and there is a movement going out of it, like, which is amazing. Like, this kind of idea that Yasmin was able to find you on a hashtag on Twitter, and me being able to be found and find other people who are like-minded. I mean, I found Yasmin on Facebook. I found Ali on Huffington Post. I found Armin in Iran in Hezbollah headquarters. and it's really amazing. Like, other than Armin,
he doesn't even pause. He just gives it.
And actually, it was the Revolutionary Guard.
That was nice, friendly little Iraqui Ronnie.
It was the Quds Force. Like, we met at the Quds Force battle.
But maybe this is why, as Maryam Namazi says, maybe this is why now there's that tsunami of ex-Muslims. Like, and maybe there's always been all of these ex-Muslims, but we just had no way of contacting each other because, like Shazia said, we all thought we were the only one and we were all too afraid to speak up.
Last 8 years, I've heard from, I would say, tens of thousands just by email.
So that 1.6 billion number is bullshit, hey?
Of course it is.
Yeah, I mean, it's really amazing. Like, just like the past few weeks, I received people telling me that my speeches are being played in like universities across the Muslim world, like in which like a group comes in and then they put a PowerPoint and then they're like, oh, let's speak to Khalifa Faisal Matar. Like, oh, wow.
The Khalifa. Oh, that's wonderful.
There was some people who just translated my entire book into Indonesian. And it's apparently a really good translation. They sent me, and then I saw these pictures online. I'll send them to you guys of a conference that happened there, where they actually discussed it in Jakarta, and there were all these women wearing hijab in the audience and everything. And they had it was pretty wild, like in Indonesia.
Don't you just feel like every minute was worth it writing that book? Now all of those editing that you went through and everything, like, it's just like, that's amazing. That's better than like the New York Times review and the award that you got and all the other accolades. Like,
that's why I wrote the book. I wrote the book basically for people over there. You can get all the awards you want here, but it's not going to make a difference. That's not the point of the book. The point of the book is for the people in the people who I've been corresponding with for the last 7 or 8 years, the people that Lishba has been corresponding with for the last 7 or 8 years, for them to read it and say, oh, okay, that's kind of what I feel. That's kind of what I think. And even the title of the book, as I told you, it's about people who are closet atheists who have to identify publicly as Muslims. So they recognize that and they look at the title and they're like, oh, okay, I get it. And the title of the book is The Atheist Muslim.
So you can, when next time you go to the bookstore or next time you're on Amazon, you're picking up The Ghori's Daughter, The Atheist Muslim,
and Mein Kampf.
Why There Is No God by Arjun Avani. And Faisal and I, our books are still on bridge. Yeah,
they are. But they're going to be out soon. So that's great.
Thank you, Shazia.
Thank you so much for coming. It was truly a pleasure. It was just hearing your stories. Like, yes. It was very inspiring. I just followed you on Twitter.
And you look like a wonderful person, Shazia. I love your accent too.
Thank you.
Yeah, adorable. It was really nice to have that accent here. Yeah,
we love everything about you.
So.
So much love. Oh,
thank you for being
here. Bye.
Thank you,
Steve. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is the last episode of Secular Jihadist.
No, it's not. Guys. No.
Don't listen to him. Never listen to Faisal. It's not
the last episode. We'll be back.
Take care,
everybody.
Bye.
The Secular Jihadists have been made possible thanks to the gracious support of the Illuminati and the great state of Israel. That's what we have been told, but we haven't received our checks yet. In the meantime, we greatly appreciate the support of our current donors. Please consider supporting by sharing the podcast with your fellow heathens or by donating at patreon.com/SJME.